When someone mentions the Fallout series, your mind probably thinks of a few things. Vault Boy, bottle caps, mutated creatures, and settlements that need your help. But for me, the first thing that comes to mind is the Pip-Boy, which serves as a lore-friendly way for players to manage their items, health, and location. It's easily the most important piece of equipment in the series. But what if, for some reason, you didn't have access to the Pip-Boy? What would happen? Well, that's what I'm here to find out, as today we figure out, can you beat Fallout 3 without opening the Pip-Boy? Here's a quick rundown of what I won't be able to do without the Pip-Boy. I can't equip any weapons or armor, so this is basically a fists-only run in a sense. I cannot heal myself with stimpaks or food, as well as Rataway. I cannot fast travel. I also cannot change quests. This isn't really an issue to be fair, as I know the map of this game pretty well at this point. And finally, I can't drop equipment, so I'll need to be careful that I don't become over-encumbered. With all that out of the way, let's begin. Upon being given life, I take a name that is sure to please dear old dad, and then assign my special stats with a focus on strength and endurance, because if I'm only going to be able to use my fists, I may as well be able to hit decently hard. I also made sure to leave myself 4 points in charisma for the child at heart perk, as per usual. We now skip ahead to the birthday party segment, and thankfully, when we are given our BB gun, it is automatically equipped, so I don't immediately fail the run. Next up is choosing our tag skills, but right as I go to, I decide to add some extra rules to spice things up a bit. Not only can I not use the Pip-Boy, but I'm also not allowing myself to loot, pickpocket, or barter for any supplies. The way I see it, when you do any of these actions, you technically open the Pip-Boy, so it's not allowed. This means I'm pretty limited in what I can choose for my tag skills. Unarmed is the only obvious one, and after going over all of them, I decide to also take Sneak and Speech. The only other skills that I may have been able to make use out of were Science and Lockpick, as everything else requires me to break one of the rules in some way or another. Nothing to talk about when escaping the vault other than having to actually hack the Overseer's terminal for once, seeing how I can't just take the password from the nearby locker. Once outside, I level up, dump everything in the Unarmed, and then take the Swift Learner perk, because the majority of the other starting perks just aren't useful to me. Out of a weird, sadistic force of habit, I go and beat up Silver, despite the fact I can't take the 300 caps from her. I then arrive in Megaton and rather quickly realise there isn't a whole lot I can do, as I can't get any items, and even if I could, I couldn't use them. I was thinking about disarming the bomb, but I lacked the explosive skill to do so. With not a whole lot of options at my disposal, I just do an immediate 180 and leave Megaton. I figured that I may as well head for Smith Casey's garage to get things started. I did actually think about following the main quest for once, rather than skipping the first half, but until I can get the Iron Fist perks to increase my hand-to-hand damage, I would probably have a miserable time trying to clear out the mutants inside the Jefferson Memorial. At least if I did things this way, I would get a whole heap of experience for rescuing my dad, which would help a lot. On the way there, it quickly became apparent just how difficult this might be, considering a one-on-one fight with a mole rat brought me down to half of my health. I'm not too surprised about the damage I'm taking, as the vault suit doesn't exactly have a high armor rating. It's more so the pitiful amount of damage I can dish out. I assumed I'd be able to kill the mole rat in one or two hits, but that was clearly not the case, unfortunately. Speaking of mole rats, as I continued west, I got attacked by another small pack of them, and it was here I realized that vats would probably be my best friend this run. Melee attacks and vats do double damage, meaning if I was lucky enough, I could get 3 punches off in vats and take down a single mole rat, then I could retreat, regain my action points, and then just rinse and repeat until they were dead. I know taking down 3 mole rats doesn't seem like much of a victory, but at this point, I'll take what I can get. That said, I came out of this fight with even less health than before, and would need to find a bed or a water source soon to at least increase my odds of making it to the garage. It was then that I saw it, like a glorious beacon on the horizon. Tenpenny Tower. It may have been slightly out of the way of where I needed to go, but I knew for a fact that I could at least get healed up there. Fallout, always wanting to mess with me however, decided to put a Yagwai between me and my salvation. Thank God I chose Sneak as one of my tag skills, or this probably wouldn't have worked. Alas, it wasn't meant to be in the end though, as I forgot to side with Mr. Burke in the Fate of Megaton quest, and as such, I would need to pay the entry fee of 100 caps to get inside. I have no idea how many caps I had, but considering I hadn't looted anything, I'd imagine it's 0. Once again, with no other options, I got back on track towards Smith Casey's. Another kick in my teeth arrived in the form of Tinker Joe, as for once in my life, I met him with completely neutral karma and could purchase one of his robots. But once again, no caps, and seeing how he was asking for 1,000 of them, this wasn't ever going to be something I could afford. I tried searching some of the nearby ruined buildings for beds or a leaky faucet, but all I got instead was rabies, which wasn't exactly a worthwhile trade-off, I can assure you. I was able to catch a break, however, as after putting down this dog and heading north, I didn't encounter any other hostile creatures. I nearly stumbled into the Evergreen Mills, which would have been a disaster, but it also let me know that I was close to my destination, and sure enough, within about 4 minutes, I arrived at the garage. Once inside, I got jumped by another 2 mole rats and only just managed to survive by the skin of my teeth. Now, I was hoping to maybe use the nearby bed and the floor, but because there's another rat underneath the floorboards, I can't. And considering I'm one hit away from certain death, fighting isn't really an option. I had one last idea though. Just next to the garage, there's a military outpost with outcast soldiers in it. If I was lucky enough, the soldiers would deal with any of the nearby enemies and I could rest in one of the beds in the outpost. Lady Luck must have shined on me today, as there wasn't anything that wanted to rip my face off at the outpost. Strangely enough, the outcast soldiers were also dead. The only nearby person was a traitor who was trying to blow up a bloatfly with a missile launcher. All I can guess is he killed the outcasts and any of the enemies, so praise be to the missile traitor because he may have just saved the run. So I find a bed, I heal up, and then I go back to the garage and go down the stairs and deal with the last mole rat and enter Vault 112 to start making some real progress. Well, I say that, but this is where I actually have some bad news. A lot of you probably already saw this coming from a mile away, but to enter the Tranquility Lounger, you need to be wearing a Vault 112 jumpsuit, and sadly, this isn't like getting into the cryo chamber in Fallout 4, I won't automatically equip it when I get in the lounger. This is also the furthest point you can skip to in the main quest, as this is mandatory to rescuing your father and beginning the work on Project Purity. So in other words, no, you cannot beat Fallout 3 without opening the Pip-Boy. Traditionally. Strap in, boys and girls, we're about to break into some speedrun struts. I technically lied when I said this is the latest point to begin the main quest. With the use of some glitches, we can get our way into Vault 87 and skip right to the part of the game where you have to get the Gek. With that in mind, I begin making my way to Little Lamplight. I try fighting some of the super mutants on the way there, and let's just say, Murder Pass in Vault 87 may be a bit of a challenge. Getting into Lamplight itself isn't really an issue. I may not have the Child of Heart perk this time, but I have more than enough points in speech that I'm able to persuade MacReady to let me in on the second attempt. I also decide to let Sticky tag along for the ride. If anything, he will work as a nice distraction for the super mutants. To begin glitching my way into the vault, I make my way down to the entrance of Murder Pass and then switch over to keyboard and mouse controls so I can do the glitch. Basically, what I'm going to do is repeatedly quick save and quick load while running against a wall, and seeing how these games are held together by nothing more than hopes and dreams, after enough attempts I will miraculously glitch through the wall and end up on the outside of the map. I've never actually done this before, and I was surprised by how easy it was to get it to work. Only downside was the wall I glitched through didn't let me walk around the gate, and all I could do was fall into the void and end up in the lower part of Little Lamplight. Next attempt, I try the opposite wall, and once again managed to clip out of bounds with very little effort. I was also lucky that from here I could crouch down and make my way under this part of the rock wall, and then do the glitch again to pop myself back into reality and be at the door to Murder Pass. You can even see my genuine excitement as I wildly spin my mouse around after pulling it off. The idea was for me to sneak past as many of the mutants as I could, but that really didn't work as I got spotted almost immediately. I was right about one thing though, most of them didn't chase me as they more than likely decided to eat Sticky instead. Getting through Murder Pass wasn't too bad. That's not to say I didn't take damage, I did. It's just, I expected to be a lot worse given the circumstance. Seeing how the run is invalid anyway, I used another glitch upon entering the vault, where if you load the autosave as you enter a new area right as you get inside, it seems to stop any enemies who were chasing you from following you into the next area. Stealth, once again, wasn't an option. The enclosed corridors of the vault are just too narrow for me to effectively sneak past all the mutants, especially with my relatively low sneak skill. Not helping matters was me getting turned around a few times inside the main area of the vault, because it all looks the same to me. As you can imagine, this led to a few deaths on my end. What's also making things more difficult is I now have to try and avoid super mutant brutes with automatic weapons, and that is next to impossible. I'm going to put it down to dumb luck that this brute for some reason didn't decide to completely unload on me with his assault rifle as the main reason I was able to even get to the test labs alive. That said, now that we're here, all we need to do is release Fox from his cell and then we should be home free, as he is more than a match for the rest of the mutants in the vault. First attempt goes pretty poorly as I get myself sandwiched between the mutants in the room of the fire alarm and this one running down the hall with a hunting rifle. Next try, I thought maybe I could take the one with the hunting rifle down if it was just the two of us, but given my health situation, that goes about as well as you'd think. They say third time's a charm, and this time I managed to sneak past the first mutant and even activate the alarm. But on the way back to the safety of Fox's cell, I get bitch slapped by a nearby centaur and get a face full of concrete as a result. Okay, fourth attempt and I pull my knowledge and I manage to sneak past the first mutant, pull the alarm, and then manage to narrowly avoid Sid and the centaurs on the way back by jumping, and thankfully find Fox who is out of his cell and doing his best to get the attention of everything in the vault, which is of course great for me. I just crouch down and hide in the corner of his cell until I'm certain that Fox has dealt with all the nearby enemies. The game still claims there are some nearby, so I can't sleep in the bed in the cell, but as luck would have it, there's a sink in here, meaning I can fully heal myself that way. From here, the rest of the vault plays out as normal with Fox taking center stage. In my defense, I do help him with a few of the mutants, but really, I'm only getting a participation award for my efforts. I also let Fox get the Gek, because I'm already irradiated enough from drinking the green goo that came out of the sink a moment ago. With the Gek in hand, it's now off to Ravenrock to once again fail the challenge. Once you get released from your restraints, Eden informs you about your equipment in the nearby locker, but completely unknown to me is that you have to open the locker before Eden will unlock the door. I once again tried glitching my way out of bounds. I attempted this for close to 20 minutes, but after all that, I wasn't even slightly clipping through the walls, so I'm effectively stuck in here unless I loot the locker. Considering I failed the challenge as soon as I glitched my way into Murder Pass, I just used console commands to open the door and leave that way. Sure, I could have just opened the locker and failed that way, but I'm a pretty stubborn person, and I'm going to fail this way instead. I also got enough experience from getting the Gek that I leveled up twice and was able to take the first point in the Iron Fist perk, meaning at the very least I would have some decent offensive capabilities. Which to be fair is now more important than ever, as not only am I about to have to deal with Enclave soldiers, but I also now have literally zero protection as my vault suit is inside the locker that I mentioned. Turns out, fighting the Enclave was a bad move, as by the time I got to Eden, I was once again back down to about 10% health. On a more positive note, once I take the modified FEV virus from the President, I get the assistance of some laser turrets, as well as some sentry bots which easily rip a path through the Enclave for me. Once outside, I'm greeted by an unexpected sight, and no, I don't mean this Enclave soldier. Although, I'll admit, that is rather impressive. But no, Sticky is here, and he somehow survived his encounter with the Super Mutants. I'm not even being sarcastic, that's genuinely impressive. I try to convince Fox to join me, but my karma is nowhere near high enough, so it's the Nurbit and Sticky show for now, I guess. Thanks to me recently having to run across the map in the Mr. Burke video from a few weeks ago, I know to avoid going too deep into this area to avoid the raiders and Mirelurks, especially considering one of them appears to have a missile launcher this time. I do decide to take a risk by getting close to the group of Mirelurks, as I need to drink water from the river to at least give me a fighting chance of making it to the Citadel in one piece. During the journey, I end up stumbling across some raiders at a power station. Thanks to the points in the Iron Fist perk, I am more than able to dispatch them quickly. Even the two raiders inside with the shotgun and the flamer weren't much of an issue, and once they were out of the way, I was able to rest in the nearby bed to heal my crippled limbs, as well as level up, and was able to max out my unarmed as well as get another point into the Iron Fist perk. To test how much damage my fists were now doing, I decided to head back and fight some of the Mirelurks. Pretty shocked to say, they really didn't pose much of a threat anymore. Granted, I still have all the defense of a wet noodle, but my damage output is pretty good all things considered. And now, one of the biggest coincidences of this run, I somehow, without trying, ended up in Big Town. This would have been pretty great if Sticky was here to see this, as at some point between fighting the raiders and the Mirelurks, he ran off and I never saw him again. No clue if he really died this time, but oh well. I figured though that if I couldn't bring Sticky to Big Town, I would bring Big Town to Sticky. So I wiped the town off the face of the map. This wasn't difficult at all, but I got a good laugh in the fact that I somehow managed to kill Dusty with a nearby oil drum while in Vats. I also took a wrong turn on my way to the Citadel, and instead of coming round past the Super Duper Mart, I instead ended up in Grey Ditch. I killed a few ants before deciding it wasn't worth the effort and began to leave when who should I spot but the devil himself.
Not today, Brian.
After escaping his clutches, I also fight my way through the Troll Raiders before making my way to the Citadel. But wait, we gotta get inside first, because since we skipped the first three quarters of the game, we never triggered the event that lets me enter the Citadel. Getting into the Citadel is just as simple as glitching through this wall and then going up to the other side of the door and entering from there. This gives me straight up Oblivion vibes. Now it's just a matter of the walk to the Purifier. This was made extra agonizing this time as the Enclave thought it would be funny to cripple my legs, thus making the journey even longer. Once at the memorial, I took my anger out on the soldiers while Sarah sat back and watched as a half-naked man with no weapons effortlessly fought off the Brotherhood's greatest enemy like it was nothing. I also did the old swing my fist wildly trick on Autumn so he wouldn't engage in dialogue, and then proceeded to beat him down in Vats before he got the chance to really do anything. I also caused one of the Enclave soldiers to melt through the floor. I decided that I would do the most neutral option by offering to sacrifice myself, but not really, and I would also insert the modified FEV virus. With that, I entered the code, finished the game, and proved you cannot beat Fallout 3 without opening the Pip-Boy. This was one of the more difficult challenges without a doubt. It's crazy how limited you are when the Pip-Boy is out of the picture. To be fair, my extra rules didn't really help matters, but considering how simple the Dragonborn challenge ended up being, I thought it was only right to make this one extra difficult. Regardless, that's going to be the end of this challenge video. If you enjoyed what you saw, consider giving the video a like, and if you're interested in more challenges in the future, feel free to subscribe. I try to have one of these videos out every week. My name's Nurbit, stay safe everyone, I'll see y'all in the next video.